everyone, and welcome to a series of interviews with Open Medicine Foundation's directors that we'll be sharing with you throughout our Triple Giving November. I am Dr. Danielle Meadows, OMF's Vice President of Research and Operations. And this week, to kick things off, I am really thrilled to be joined by the director of our Ronald G. Tompkins Harvard ME CFS Collaboration, Dr. David Systrom. As a brief introduction, Dr. Systrom's center focuses on understanding the mechanisms underlying ME-CFS, long COVID, and other chronic complex diseases, with a special emphasis on post-exertional malaise, and then finding new and better treatments to improve patient care. So welcome, Dr. Systrom.
Thank you, Danielle, for inviting me.
So today I want to chat with you about one of your studies that's trying to understand post-exertional malaise, the muscle biopsy study. So to start us out, can you give us a high-level overview of the rationale and background for this project?
Sure. So I think, as many in the audience know, post-exertional malaise is one of the characteristic features of ME-CFS, myalgic encephalomyelitis, chronic fatigue syndrome. It's a distinct feature, and it serves to differentiate clinically from other forms of fatigue and exertional intolerance, for instance. So post-exertional malaise is a characteristic feature, in fact, required for the diagnosis of ME-CFS. What patients tell us in the clinic is that if they overdo on one occasion, and generally speaking, that's physical activity, but it can also be overdoing cognitively or even emotionally, that they will, quote, pay the price later. And that later is usually 12, 24, or 48 hours later. Severe PEM is often described as a crash, and it can persist for days, weeks, and even months at a time. So it is, again, a characteristic feature of the disease, and studying it, we think, will serve several purposes. One is to gain insight into the pathophysiology of the disease, what actually is triggering all of the symptoms, including exertional intolerance in such patients. But it's also a really debilitating symptom. So better understanding the symptom and what drives it physiologically is incredibly important for the patients. And hopefully, ultimately, we can direct therapy at PEM, post-exertional malaise, and make patients better. So this particular study is designed to determine, in a pathophysiologic sense, what is driving post-exertional malaise. And we have several angles, several different approaches with biomarkers, bloodborne biomarkers, and muscle biopsies in an attempt to better understand post-exertional malaise. One of the things that has piqued our interest in all of this has been our invasive cardiopulmonary exercise test at the Brigham, which we've been doing for over 6 or 7 years in ME-CFS, and of course, more recently in long COVID. And what we've discovered is that there are some vascular abnormalities, apparent vascular abnormalities, in patients both with ME and long COVID. They seem to be shared disproportionately in women, where we have some evidence of preload failure or preload insufficiency, which is low pressures feeding the right heart during upright cycling exercise. But additionally, in a subset of patients, especially women, impaired oxygen extraction by the muscle at peak exercise. Have thought about what might be driving that latter phenomenon. One is vascular abnormality, very similar to the preload failure, where we have a very high prevalence of something called small fiber neuropathy that we diagnose with skin biopsy. The small fiber nerves mediate things like pain, but we've also more recently discovered that they play a major role in autonomic function, including blood vessel tone and therefore blood flow during exercise. So one hypothesis is that what ails patients during exercise and with post-exertional malaise is this impaired vascular function, neurovascular function, where blood flow is not appropriately directed to the exercising muscle, and even more particularly to the exercising muscle mitochondrion. So that's one theory, that impaired oxygen extraction and things like fatigue, brain fog, lightheadedness, and even PEM is a blood flow abnormality related to the autonomic nervous system. But the second possibility, and this has gained some traction really over the past 8 to 9 months, with our work and with the work of some collaborators in Amsterdam, is that the muscle mitochondrion may play a role in this impaired oxygen extraction. So with the invasive CPET, which involves a mouthpiece and a metabolic cart and a pulmonary artery catheter and a radial artery catheter, this impaired oxygen extraction by the muscle, we can demonstrate, but we can't really differentiate between blood flow abnormalities and mitochondrial dysfunction, intrinsic mitochondrial dysfunction. So this study is meant to address that very question. When we see most often a woman with ME, CFS, and or long COVID who has post-exertional malaise, is this a mitochondrial problem in the muscle? Is this a blood flow abnormality, or is it both? And this muscle biopsy study is meant to address that. So the protocol is a pretty simple one. On day one, they have some baseline bloods drawn. We're sending plasma for proteomics to SomaLogic. We are sending plasma to collaborator in Montreal, Elaine Moreau, who is doing transcriptomics, and we are doing metabolomics at Metabolon. So there will be a variety of bloodborne biomarkers that will be obtained both on day one and, as I'll tell you about, day eight, which is the last day of the study. The other thing we do on day one is a muscle biopsy. It's frozen so that we can interrogate live mitochondria later. So all that's done on day one. That's a muscle biopsy done by one of our interventionalists, and the blood, which is plasma, for the omics that I just mentioned. Additionally, we're sending whole blood to Dr. Maureen Hansen at Cornell for interrogation of peripheral blood mononuclear cells, which may give us some further insight into the mitochondrial function, for instance. So on day seven, they return and they do semi-exhaustive exercise. It's not meant to be too onerous, but what we're attempting to do is precipitate a little bit of PEM the next day. And of course, our patients are aware of that. It's a non-invasive cardiopulmonary exercise test. We purposely create a shallow workload, meaning they go about twice as long as they did for a previous clinically indicated invasive CPET. And again, that's meant to increase the exercise burden a bit and precipitate PEM the next day. And the next day they return for the very same things they get on the baseline day. So another needle muscle biopsy, frozen, sent to our collaborators, and all the bloodborne omics. So what we're doing is, based on the initial invasive CPET, is determining all of the patients by definition, and it's an inclusion criterion, have the clinical phenomenon of PEM. Half of the patients have poor oxygen extraction at peak exercise, and half of them do not. So we're asking the question, does the invasive CPET identification of poor oxygen extraction sort of enrich the possibility of having mitochondrial dysfunction?
Yeah, excellent. So that's great. You've covered, you know, some of your hypotheses around these work, and, you know, connecting the vascular dysfunction to the mitochondrial dysfunction, and you know, having that comparator group is also going to be really interesting to not have the post-exertional malaise and see what that difference is. So that's going to be really, really great work. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, how might results be translated to the clinic in the future?
Yeah, so at least with current thinking, the treatment of neurovascular dysfunction is very different from the treatment of intrinsic mitochondrial dysfunction. There is a national organization called the Mitochondrial Medicine Society, who has recommendations about treatment mostly directed at genetic forms of mitochondrial myopathy. But the treatment of the neurovascular dysregulation is a different animal. At least with current knowledge, it's directed largely at this small fiber autonomic neuropathy that we have treated actively with another off-label comment, drugs such as pyridostigmine or mestinon, which is FDA-approved medication for myasthenia gravis. So anyway, the original question was how would we potentially create some precision medicine in treating individually neurovascular dysregulation versus mitochondrial dysfunction. And right now they are very different animals, as it were.
Yeah. So it almost sounds like, if you find the connections that you're potentially expecting to find from this study between the vascular dysregulation and the mitochondrial dysfunction, that you might be able to guide treatments in the future just using the invasive CPET that you use in the clinic as it is. Does that sound right?
That's exactly right.
Great. So oftentimes, when we talk about ME-CFS and especially PEM, it triggers a automatic thought of doing a two-day CPET. So in this particular study, why are you using, just the one day of CPET, and how does that differ from a two-day CPET?
Right. The two-day CPET, pioneered by Betsy Keller in Ithaca, is a useful modality. It's non-invasive, and it appears to identify reasonably reliably at least some physiologic manifestations of PEM. So the idea is you do the first exercise test and get a VO2 max and a non-invasive anaerobic threshold, and then you repeat it the next day when the patient is suffering from PEM, and you can quantify a decrease in the VO2 peak and decrease in the anaerobic threshold. This is really taking a deeper dive, we think, into the pathophysiology of what might drive those two things. So the VO2 peak decreasing and the anaerobic threshold decreasing on day two can be driven by neurovascular dysregulation, or it can be driven by newly acquired or worsened mitochondrial dysfunction, perhaps all in the setting of inflammation that is precipitated by the first exercise bout. So really our exercise intervention and then studying the patient the next day is a deeper dive into the pathophysiology of what Dr. Keller has observed.
Yeah, so in some ways the two-day CPET is a way of kind of diagnosing PEM, but in this case you're using the CPET to induce PEM and then look more at the molecular mechanism behind it using the proteomics and metabolomics and all the muscle analysis. Is that accurate?
That is fiercely accurate.
Okay, great. So maybe just kind of the last little bit I'll ask is, what stage is the study in now, and are there any observations that you can share at this point?
Sure. So with the help of the team, who include Johanna and Shreya and others, we've accomplished 8 muscle biopsies with a projected total number of 50 patients. So we're on our way. We have an additional 2 coming up in the next week or two. And this is all over the past month or so. So we've launched this with our collaborators, receiving the samples that I mentioned, that took a little bit to organize, but is now a well-greased path, and we are well on our way.
Well, that's very exciting. Good to hear. And so with that, I will just kind of wrap things up for our little short interview today. And thank you so much for joining me, Dr. Systrom.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Meadows. It was my pleasure.